everyone, Laurel here with an intermediate exponents question from the data sufficiency section of the GMAT. So before we get into it together, go ahead and pause the video, take a couple minutes, and try this problem out on your own. So we have a lot going on here, and in data sufficiency especially, it can be kind of hard to know where to start. And the number one thing that I really recommend you do first on data sufficiency is to simplify the question stem. So in this case, the GMAT has told us that P is X to the A plus B over X to the B. Now, I know a secret about the GMAT, which is that the GMAT always gives you information in the least helpful way possible. So do not be fooled by X to the A plus B over X to the B. Actually sit back and ask yourself if there is any way that you can make this more simple. And in this case, I actually have a bit of a clue here, which is that there is the same variable in the numerator of the fraction as the denominator, which is B. And I'm kind of thinking, oh, there's probably something I can get simplified here. In this case, it's actually going to take knowing our exponent rules. And so you may remember from back in the day, whenever you learned this, that 2 to the third power times 2 squared, for example, is 2 to the 3 plus 2, which is 2 to the 5. And the reason for this, just to refresh, is that 2 cubed is like multiplying 2 by itself 3 times, and 2 squared 2 times, which if we add these all up is 2 to the 5th power. Now the generalizable form here, and you do need to know this for the test, is that a to the x times a to the y is a to the x plus y. Okay, so now we can look at this question stem here and say, I see. We are going to rewrite the top of our fraction as x to the a times x to the b over x to the b. This is going to give me a huge step forward, which is that I can actually cancel my x to the b's, leaving me with that p is x to the a. Now, the second thing I'm going to do before I jump into my statements is write down what I'm solving for and any additional information. So in this case, I want to know what P equals. What is X to the A equal to? And the last thing I want to do before I jump in is just note any little pieces of information. And in this case, the GMAT has told me that P is positive and it is an integer. And I'm going to write those down in case they're relevant later on. Okay, so now I have all of this information mapped out. I've simplified the question stem really beautifully, and I want to take a quick moment just to ask myself, is there anything more I could do here? Could I make this even more simple? And the answer in this case is no. X to the A is about as simple as it's going to come, and so I'm ready to go ahead and move into the statements. All right, so statement 1 tells me that X is 5. And another trap I see a lot of folks fall into is that they see this and they think, oh, there's no way this is sufficient. I'm gonna move right along to statement 2 and then combining them. And that would be another huge mistake here. And the reason for that is that the GMAT knows that you're gonna look at this and think, oh, I need to know X and A to determine X to the A. And it is very likely there is a trap here, which is that you actually don't need both of those pieces of information. So to find out if that's true or not, I'd really recommend that you try some numbers out. In this case, I know that I'm trying to find x to the a, and that's going to let me try out some options for x and a. I know in statement 1 that x is 5. Let's say that a is 1 and 2. If a is 1, that means x to the a is 5, and if a is 2, that means it is 25. Because these are two different values, I now know that statement 1 definitively is not sufficient to answer the question. And that is going to let me eliminate choices A and D. All right, Moving on to statement two, and it's the same drill here. You might already be thinking, oh, well, knowing X wasn't sufficient, so knowing A won't be sufficient either. But always take a quick moment to test it, because the GMAT is quite sneaky. And in this case, again, X and A, I know that A is always zero. Let's try one and two for X. And this is actually a spot where you need to know another exponent rule, which is that anything to the zeroth power is one. So 2 to the zeroth is also 1. 17 to the zeroth is also 1. I'm going to add that to our list over here. Anything to the zeroth power always equals 1 on the GMAT. And that means that statement 2 is actually sufficient. So even though we don't know what X is, we actually don't care. X to the A, which is what we're looking for, is always 1, and that's going to make this sufficient. Meaning I can go ahead and choose answer choice B. Okay, there's a lot going on here, and just a couple things to recap. Number one, always rephrase the question stem. Do not let the GMAT get you on your heels where you are trying to solve a question in the way the GMAT has given it to you. Take the time to put it in terms that you understand. Secondly, do not assume that just because it looks like something is insufficient, that it is insufficient. Actually take the time to test out a couple numbers and prove it one way or another. And then lastly, you do need to know some exponent rules when you go into the GMAT, and so make sure you learn these and the other rules that you have to know before you go into testing. Thanks for watching. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep. And leave us a comment telling us how you solved this question. Happy studying!